All right, well, let's get started. Welcome to our third webinar in the Getting Started with FLOW-3D Hydro series. Today we will talk about sediment transport in FLOW-3D Hydro. So I'm Eric Lamont, work for Flow Science Australasia based in Brisbane, joined by Pankaj on the Q&A again. And today we will look at just a brief overview of sediment transport in FLOW-3D Hydro, a couple validation examples. We'll do a continuation of the weir spillway example that we've been working on for the other webinars. We'll add sediment transport to that one. And then at the end, we'll have a Q&A, and you can submit questions to Pankaj throughout. You don't have to wait till the end. So again, these are meant to be short webinars. There's a lot of detail for sediment transport that we can't cover in a short time. We have one more webinar coming up in a few weeks for post-processing. So a brief overview of sediment transport. Before we start, sediment in your models will consist of either suspended sediment, which is sediment in the water drifting along with the flow, or it'll be packed sediment. So this is sediment on the bed. Just a note about the suspended sediment. Even though FLOW-3D can model particles, this is actually tracked as more of a sediment concentration as a scalar quantity. So you're not actually modeling individual particles for visualization. And a thing to point out is these two interact with each other. So it's dynamic. Suspended sediments can settle to become packed sediments, and then packed sediments can erode to become in suspension. So the mechanisms for this in your models, you can settle sediments, so just by gravity settling on the bed. Advection, so suspended sediment carried with the water. Entrainment, or erosion, so sediment being pulled from the bed and into suspension. And bed load transport is just when the sediment kind of moves along on the bed. The packing, so when the bed load or suspended sediments just kind of form a stationary bed. And also this angle of repose. So it's just, this is just the natural angle your sediments would form. With all of these, there are a lot of parameters that influence them that we don't get into. The sediment transport physics are probably some of the deepest things that give you a lot of options on how to adjust these things. We won't get into that today purely because of time, but just to consider that. So how does this work in your model? So it's a transient representation of scour. First, you evaluate the hydraulics like you normally would in a FLOW-3D model. The shear stress outputs then influence the sediment behavior. And you're tracking the suspended sediments. Your solid actually adjusts based on the behavior of the sediment. So the erosion or settling or bed load, it'll actually adjust your solids, which then will impact your hydraulics. So the hydraulics are solved again. And so what you end up having is this dynamic cycle. So every time step, your hydraulics feed the sediment behavior feed the geometry changes, which impact the hydraulics. So it just keeps cycling through, and you get this dynamic representation of sediment transport. So some things that can really have an impact on this: having accurate hydraulics, which feed accurate, you know, shear stress values, mesh size, which we'll show in the validation, can have a big impact. You have different bed load equations you can choose from. The roughness, which will impact your shear stress. So getting that correct. So right now with sediment characteristics, you can have up to 10 different sediment species, which we'll show you how to do. And the limitation right now is that it's only non-cohesive soils. And this can be relatively longer run times, because with sediment transport problems, you're often looking at a long duration. One thing I'll point out is it does still work with our shallow water mesh as well. So that's one way you can cut down on run times, depending on what you're looking at. So why would you model sediment transport? Some of the common things would be to assess the risk of erosion. The photos on the right were from a project I did a long time ago where they're experiencing erosion for culvert outlets. But also, it's not just erosion you can look at in the sediment transport model. You can look at deposition rates. So if you had a culvert or a pump intake that had settling was an issue, that could potentially reduce your hydraulic capacity. Environmental impacts. So modeling the sediment concentration in the water column, often that is an environmental concern. But also looking at processes that revolve around settling. So your grit tanks, settling ponds, those are some of the examples. So a few quick examples. On the top left is just a propeller wash example. You'll see a simplified propeller will start to kick up some scour. On the bottom left is just a simple contraction at a culvert causing some scour. On the bottom right, another bridge example, this time with piers, just looking at different pier configurations and how the scour is impacted. And the top right is a culvert outlet, just looking at scouring, kind of like that those photos from the previous page. And just a couple examples of deposition. So this is a simple grit tank looking at settling. And then on the right is like a stormwater pond. It might be hard to see, but the top bay on the top of the page will start to fill up with sediment as flow comes in. So you can track the suspended sediment moving through the pond and looking at how much sediment settles out. So one thing I like to point out is within Flow-3D Hydro, we have built-in examples, and one of them is for sediment scour. So these are good, kind of like a sandbox for playing around with things. So this is a good one to reference if you're just getting into modeling scour. We'll use it as an example for going through some of these steps. So how you specify it, it's kind of similar to the moving object webinar last week. The first step is in the physics. The second step can be in the geometry if you're defining an erodible object. And then there's some other options. So if you want suspended sediment to come into your model, you can do that through boundary conditions, initial conditions, or mass sources. So that's your physics. And when you open the physics, you get the option to activate the sediment transport, define the number of species. So for this example, there are three. And then down below, you input the particle size, density, some of these other inputs. For this example, all the other bed load inputs, all the other defaults, we're just going to use as they are. So again, three species. We're going to define in the geometry now the part of the model in that example that will erode. So you can see this blue object here. We change to a packed sediment option or type. And down below, you have packed sediment properties. So now, because we've defined three different particle species, you can define a particle distribution here. For this example, it was just equal distribution. So that blue object will be able to erode when we run the model. And so this is what it looks like. So on the top, that's with the sediment transport on. Just as a comparison, I turned off sediment transport, so it's the same model on the bottom. But you can see how for the same hydraulics, how the sediment transport ends up with a different looking model. So validations, just real quick. We've done a simple one around a diamond shaped pier. So the plot is looking at that scour hole evolution over time. And on this next page, this is just sensitivity testing for some of those inputs like mesh size, bed load equation, just to illustrate that this is a very sensitive model based on your inputs. So in this case, we did have data to calibrate to and were able to find something that matched pretty well. Same thing was done with a different shape pier. No video for that one. This is an old one, but it was looking at that dune formation under a submerged gate. It's kind of an old old video, but you'll see that dune just evolve over time. And this one validated pretty well. We won't sit and watch this. And just one I added quick, because it was an Australian example. This was done by JBA Consulting in the UK. This was after a cyclone where they saw erosion at a bridge. So it's the same bridge on the left and the right before and after. And this model was done probably more in a qualitative sense, but they matched the scour at the same locations that were observed in a full 3D model for that one. So now our model example. So we're going to build on that same model we looked at in the previous webinars. We're going to make a quick change to the geometry just to simplify it downstream. We're going to run an initial hydraulic condition and use that to feed our sediment transport model. So we'll go through some of these steps quickly. The first thing you would do is create a copy of that previous model. We've done that in previous webinars, so I won't go through it again, but you basically right-click, create a copy. Everything else we're going to keep the same. So the geometry changes on the left is what we had been working with. On the right is how I simplified it downstream. I wanted just a simple flat surface for our rotable area, which will be the green object right there. And confined the walls to make it just be a little simpler, just for the sake of a sediment transport example. But everything else, there's the same boundary conditions and everything. So if I run that model, I get this kind of steady condition. So from this, I'm going to restart this and activate our sediment transport physics. So to create restart, we did this in the last webinar. Again, it's just a right click and you create a restart. You pick the time that you want to restart from. So I'm just going to choose the end of my model run. And the other thing, I'll make this run for 120 seconds for this example. And so now getting into the things that change. So this is where we'll specify sediment transport. So you go to the physics, go down to our sediment transport. We'll turn this on and we'll activate it. And so here's where you could define a number of sediment species. For this example, we'll keep it simple and just do one. So we'll just do one particle size of 0.002. And you'll see the variable density flow activates automatically. You don't need to use this, but the suspended sediment will influence the local fluid viscosity and density. So we'll keep that on. So now we'll turn on the packed sediment object in the geometry window. So see, we have this separate object in green. By default, it's a solid. We'll change it to packed sediment. And when we do that, down below in the subcomponent properties, you'll see this packed sediment properties come up. So because we just have one sediment species, we only have one show up. But if you had multiple, you could define the distribution of sediments in that object. So once we've done that, all we have to do is run it. And this is what it looks like. You'll see downstream that erodible area can erode. You'll see kind of on the right, there's a little piling up of sediments. But just a simple example using a simple erodible area. And so now once we've done this, we can test different designs. So on the right, I just did a kind of a deeper dissipator and remove that end sill. And you can see, so even though this is, this isn't a calibrated example, we haven't really validated this. These are still valuable models when you're looking at different designs. You can clearly see the one on the right. You know, there's some erosion, but certainly not as much as the one on the left. So even these, I would say, uncalibrated examples can still give you some insight when using the sediment transport model. And that's it. So it's really just activate the physics, define it in the geometry, and the same steps as before, really. So that's all we were going to cover today. Just a reminder, our next one is in a few weeks. We'll look at post-processing mostly in Flow-3D post. So while you're thinking of questions, just some upcoming events. We have a webinar next week hosted by our US counterparts. It's early morning in Australia, but if you register, you'll get a recording of this. For those of you in Australia, next week I'll be in Sydney for a conference. And we do have our World Users Conference coming up next year. So that was it for today. Are there any questions in the chat or Q&A? And if there aren't, I guess we'll just end there. If there are any questions after this, just email myself or Pankaj. But thanks for showing up, and we'll see you again in a couple weeks. Thanks. Bye.